Dear Guntis Belevis, dear Minister, dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, during the 2013 Lithuanian Presidency of the European Union, I had the great privilege as then the Health Minister of Lithuania, like Guntis Belevis today, of hosting the Vilnius Forum and supporting the Vilnius Declaration. It's in my hands, Vilnius Declaration. You know, I take it, and I am very happy that today we have second option. At the time, I did not know that in less than 2 years, I would be attending a follow-up event as a European Commissioner for with responsibility for health. I'm delighted to be here today to take forward with you discussions about the future of health systems in the European Union. I warmly thank the responsible stakeholder organizations for arranging this forward-looking event and Minister Belevis for promoting it under the Latvian presidency. The Vilnius Declaration was a call for action from the stakeholders to the European Union institutions, to the Commission also, and governments, in particular ministers in Council and the European Commission, as I mentioned. I believe this call for action was heard in the European Commission. In 2014, we adopted an European Union agenda for effective, accessible, and resilient health systems that takes up many of the issues of the declaration. This agenda describes and brings together the different activities ongoing at European Union level to support member states in reforming their health systems. The communication highlights the opportunity for cooperation at European Union level on various issues, such as health workforce planning, patient safety and quality of care, cross-border healthcare, health technology assessment, e-health, or the cost-effective use of medicines. It's very important. For me, the declaration was also one of the sources of inspiration last year when framing my priorities for my term as European Commissioner. In particular, my focus on prevention, promotion, and protection. Therefore, let me start with the first call of the declaration, which was to so-called increase investment in health promotion and disease prevention. Vilnius Declaration encourages investing in cost-effective preventive measures in healthcare system and in public health. These measures for the latter, I believe, must be part of the policies and all budgets. Why it is important? To be really effective in prevention, we must act on public health level by integrating concrete measures in the instruments managed by all the ministers. And we must do so in a coordinated manner, linking our goals to national indicators and benchmarks, and coordinating financial resources through different levels of power. Local, regional, national, and finally European. Only then we will be realistically able to manage effectively the risk factors. In very concrete terms, I'm speaking about different things, as investing, for example, in teachers for physical education, building biking roads, or carrying public relations campaigns, among many others. Cross-sectorial measures could great deal in preventing the alcohol-related harm and obesity, in particular in relation to young people. I believe the wake-up call from Vilnius has helped to motivate member states to endorse the European action plans on youth and binge drinking and on childhood obesity last year. It is obvious that this cannot be managed from the budget of the health ministry alone. The money for disease prevention must come through budgets of all ministers, ministries, and departments. And it needs to be spent according to concrete goals, indicators, and with proper evaluation. Well, this is where we need to invest today in order to benefit tomorrow. I am sure we would benefit in terms of personal health, the so-called health of our health systems, and the health of our economies. For instance, smoking is the biggest avoidable cause of death in Europe, with some 700,000 people dying each and every year of diseases caused by tobacco. Can you imagine? 700,000 people every year. A huge challenge for the European Union. As Lithuanian Health Minister, I had the honor to participate in and steer during the Lithuanian Presidency the successful negotiations on the Tobacco Products Directive. My services are now working with member states to ensure the timely and effective implementation of this directive. This is crucial, of course, as it is estimated that overall effect of the directive will be a 2% reduction in European Union tobacco consumption over 5 years. We are on the right track and have come a long way in our work, but there is a lot left to do. I am currently considering the best way to support member states in their effort to prevent and manage chronic diseases, diseases that account for up to 80% of all healthcare costs in the European Union, approximately about 700 billion per year. The second call from Vilnius was to ensure universal access to high-quality, people-centered health services. This call was primarily addressed to the member states because access to health care falls mainly under their competence. However, we must be attentive to the fact that at European Union member states level, primary and secondary care is managed in cost-effective and integrated manner. That said, there is also an EU dimension. We can all take pride in having access to healthcare enshrined in the European Charter of Fundamental Rights. However, to what extent an individual can actually enjoy and benefit from that right can depend on where you live and how much you earn. There are 6 member states: Estonia, Poland, Latvia, Bulgaria, Greece, Romania, in which more than 8% of the population report unmet needs for medical examination, while the European Union average is about 3.6%. And it is mostly those with the lowest income in a society that report the most unmet medical needs. I'm pleased to see that a number of stakeholders who were present in Vilnius have since created a partnership for greater equality in the access to care. In addition, an interest group has been created in the European Parliament. It's very excellent. Furthermore, there is an increasing interest among member states to reflect jointly on how to increase patient access to innovative medicines and foster discussions on pricing. This will be discussed at the Council's working party level next month. Plus, the implementation of the Directive on Patients' Right in Cross-Border Healthcare Directive, which is one of my priorities, will help to further improve access to healthcare in the European Union. I will soon present a report on member states' compliance to meet the obligations under this directive. The directive also creates new models of cooperation at European Union level. For instance, I will launch by the end of this year calls for the first European networks, reference networks, of highly specialized healthcare providers. By pooling and exchanging knowledge and expertise across borders, these networks will increase access to care, in particular for patients suffering from rare or complex diseases or conditions where expertise is uncommon. On the basis of the directive, an e-health network with representatives from all member states was created and has adopted guidelines on patient summaries and e-prescriptions, which will facilitate an easier and more effective exchange of health data across internal European Union borders. And I welcome that the new strategy for a digital single market underlines the opportunities that digital technologies for health and care offer for citizens. Finally, the third call for actions to ensure that health systems reforms are evidence-based and focused on cost-effectiveness, sustainability, and good governance. Again, while this call was addressed primarily to the member states, the European Union can provide support. The European Union agenda for effective, accessible, and resilient health systems also underlines the need for health information at European Union level, in particular, European health indicators to support member states. At the start of the new commission, President Juncker asked me to develop expertise for assessing the performance of health systems. Accordingly, I created a new expert group on health system performance assessment, which will develop tools to support national policymakers in taking decisions to improve their health systems. More broadly, the reform of health system has, over recent years, become an integral element in the European economic governance. Every year, the European Union addresses country-specific recommendations on health to a number of member states, mainly on the sustainability, effectiveness, and accessibility of healthcare. And in many countries, reforms will be supported by the European Structural and Investment Fund. Another important means of strengthening effectiveness and good governance of health systems is through the health technology assessment. Through cooperation on health technology assessment, I want to facilitate an effective exchange of information among competent national authorities to avoid duplication of processes, methods, and expenditure. Finally, I would like to call that we make greater use of big data that is already in the hands of the European Medicine Agency. For instance, clusters of member states and industry can cooperate to better exploit those data in order to support evidence-based policy. Ladies and gentlemen, Minister, I think the past 2 years since the Vilnius Declaration has seen some important progress on the path to health system for inclusive growth. Now is the time, after the call for action, to come up with a plan for action and to define more precisely how member states, European Union institutions, and stakeholders should invest in health and well-being for all. We still await that much-needed paradigm shift in European Union health policy. Our health systems need to reduce inequalities in health status and empower people as patients and as citizens. The future of our health systems affects everybody, politicians, stakeholders, and last but not least, every one of us as citizens and patients. So let's not lose our objectives, reduce the number of early deaths, lift some pressure from public spending related to due chronic diseases, and make healthcare more effective. This will contribute greatly in Commission's goals for jobs and growth. Thank you, colleagues.